Hi, today we're going to cover Chapter 5 on Ethernet technology. So in Chapter 5, we're going to talk about the following things, basically about the Ethernet sublayers, and we're going to talk about the different fields of the Ethernet frame. We're also going to cover about what we call the MAC address, or sometimes we call it the physical address. And we're going to discuss about the Address Resolution Protocol, or ARP, and how it impacts our network and performance. And lastly, we're going to talk about some basic switching concepts and how it's actually configured on our network. And lastly, we are going to talk about a little bit on the layer 3 switching. So in Chapter 5, these are the topics that we're going to cover. So for the Ethernet protocol, is one of the most widely used LAN technologies. It operates in the data link layer and the physical layer. So the family of the Ethernet technology is defined by the IEEE 802.2 and 802.3 standards, and it supports a variety of different network speeds. The Ethernet standards can be broken up into two separate layers, namely the Logical Link Control Layer (LLC) and also the MAC sublayer. So in graphical context, this is how it looks like. This is our OSI 7 layers. And under the OSI 7 layers, our Ethernet networks actually belongs to the data link and the physical layer over here. So for the Ethernet LLC network, so what we'll do is it actually handles the communication between the upper and lower layers, and it also takes the network protocol data and adds additional control information to ensure that the packet reaches the destination. For the MAC layer, it is a lower sublayer of the data link layer. It is responsible to control the hardware, typically with the computer network card. Network interface card. Okay, the two primary responsibilities of the MAC layer is actually for the data encapsulation for media access control. So for data encapsulation, what it does is it will actually frame the data before transmission, and upon reaching the destination, it will actually disassemble the frame. And the MAC layer actually adds a header and a trailer packet to the network layer PDU. There are three primary functions of the MAC sublayer. Basically, it does the frame delimiting, where a group of bits actually will make ensure the frames are actually synchronized between the transmitting and the receiving destination. For the addressing function, the MAC layer handles what we call the MAC address, or sometimes we call it the physical address. So this MAC address ensures that the data packet is sent to the correct destination. For the last part, the error detection, Ethernet frames actually contain what we call a cyclic redundancy check, or CRC view. If the data reaches a destination and it fails the CRC check, the data will be discarded and it will be retransmitted again. So the MAC address layer actually does the following control of the frames on the media and removing the frames. And it communicates directly with the physical layer. If the data is collided, it will result in what we call corrupted and unusable data. In order to prevent this from happening, what it does is it uses a technology known as Carrier Sense Multiple Access CSMA technology. This is a key of what we use in the Ethernet. So let's take a look at how Carrier Sense Multiple Access, or CSMA, works. So in general, before the computer starts to transmit, it will try to detect if the media is carrying a signal or not. If no carrier signal is detected, the device will start to transmit its data. However, if two devices start to transmit at the same time, we have what we call a data collision. So in general, there are what we call the contention-based access, and the stations, they can actually transmit at the same time. So if they transmit at the same time, they have what we call data collision. And this is very typical of what we see in the wireless and wired network. So for the CSMA control, what it does is it will actually do the two ways, CSMA collision detection or CSMA collision avoidance. Okay, for CSMA collision detection or CSMA-CD, it will monitor the media for the data signal. So if there isn't any data signal, it means that the media is free and the media can device can transmit the data. However, if it detects that another device is transmitting, all the devices will stop sending and try again later. While the Ethernet networks are designed with the CSMA-CD technology, collisions do not really occur and the CSMA technology are unfortunately unnecessary. So wireless connection on the other hand will have to consider collisions of data packet. For the wireless systems, they use what we call a CSMA collision avoidance media access method. So the device will examine the media to see whether there are any transmission of data signals. If the media is free, the device will send a notification across the media to ensure that nobody else will use it. After that, the device will send the data, and this is governed by what we call the 802.11 wireless networking technologies. MAC addresses are actually defined as 48-bit binary numbers, or they can be represented by a set of 12 hexadecimal digits. This MAC address is a compulsory requirement for the hardware vendors to assign so that the addresses is actually unique for the particular device. So the MAC addresses are actually assigned to networking devices such as your workstation, servers, printers, switches, and routers, and so on. So examples of MAC address look something like this. And when the device actually forwards a packet to the Ethernet network, you will actually attach the source and destination MAC address to the frame header. And when it reaches the computer, the network interface card will actually check and see if the destination MAC address in the frame matches the device MAC address stored in the RAM. If it does not match, it will actually discard the frame. However, if the MAC address of the frame actually matches the MAC address in the RAM of the computer, the network interface card will pass the frame up to the OSI layer in the computer to actually de-encapsulate and open up for the data. So network encapsulation basically is to actually put the frame headers so that they can actually operate at different speeds. So typically network frame structures added the headers and trailers to the network to ensure that the Ethernet layer conforms to the TCP/IP network. So Ethernet 2 and the IEEE 802.3 standards define the minimum frame size as 64 bytes and maximum as 1518 bytes. So anything less than a 64 byte data length is considered a collision fragment. And if a transmitter frame is less than the minimum or greater than the maximum frame size, the receiving data will drop the frame because they do not fit the correct frame size of 64 bytes and 1518 bytes. And different versions of Ethernet vary in the method for detecting and placing data on the media. So this is a pictorial view of how the frame header looks like. So in this case, we have the frame tag of A02.1Q inside the Ethernet frame header, where it contains the following information such as your VLAN information, priority, and so on. And this is where we have the destination MAC address and the source MAC address. So the Ethernet frame consists of the following things: the preamble, start frame delimiter for synchronization between the sending and receiving devices. The length and type field indicates the size of the data that is to be sent across the network, as well as the data itself. And you also have what we call the frame check sequence for the error checking. In case there is some data error occurs, you will actually discard the frame and ask for resend if necessary. So the MAC address uses the hexadecimal number system, and this is a table of the conversion between the decimal, binary, and hexadecimal numbers. So the MAC addresses is represented in the computer under the IP config or command, where you can actually detect the MAC address in this following segment. So typical MAC addresses looks like this, with 6 bytes of numbers followed by dashes or colons. Okay, there are a few ways of transmitting the MAC address between the computer to the rest of the devices. So this is how it works. The first way is what we call the unicast MAC address. So what happens is you have to send this source computer, where we actually send a unicast MAC address to the destination of a particular server only. The rest of the other servers do not receive the MAC address. Okay, so essentially it means that unicast MAC address is only meant for one destination. Okay. And the next is what we call a broadcast MAC address. So for the broadcast MAC address, we have, let's say, this source computer, and it tries to send a MAC address request to all the computers in the network. In this case, the host group. So all the computers in the whole network will all receive the MAC address broadcasts. Okay. So in this case, broadcast means everybody will receive the network request. And finally, we have the multicast MAC address, where a multicast is just to send a MAC address to a group of hosts only. So in this case, we can see that this computer is trying to send a MAC address to only a few computers in the network. The rest who are not receiving it will be ignored. Okay, so only the destination host group will be receiving it. So multicast basically means only for a group of computers. So the MAC address is similar to the NRIC of a person. It does not change. It is also known as what we call the physical address, because it is actually physically assigned to the host's network interface card. Network interface card. On the other hand, for the IP address, it is actually similar to the address of a person. It is dependent on where the host is actually located. Okay, and the IP address is also known as a logical address because it is assigned logically. And the IP address is normally assigned by the network administrator. Both MAC address and the IP addresses are actually required for the communication of the computers. So for end-to-end connectivity, we need to ensure that the MAC address and IP address are configured in the network packet. So for end-to-end connectivity, in this case, the data link layer governs how the frame is sent across the different networks. In this case, from one network in Paris to the other network in Japan. So let's cover the next topic on the address resolution protocol. Okay, the ARP, or what we call the address resolution protocol, is actually a method to allow the computer or node to find the MAC address of the destination. Okay, so for the ARP protocol, it provides two basic functions: resolving the IPv4 addresses to the MAC address. Okay, resolving means to find the IPv4 addresses, and it will also maintain a table of mapping. In this case, what are the list of the IPv4 addresses to the MAC addresses. So in this case, let's take a look at the diagram over here. We have a source computer H1 trying to send a data packet to the destination 192.168.1.7. So in this case, the H1 computer only knows the IP address of the destination, but it does not know the MAC address of the destination. So it is unable to send to the destination in this case. So it needs to find out the MAC address before it can proceed. So the MAC address table is actually a table to list the data link layer address to the destination IPv4 address. So every time a node or the device actually receives a frame from the network, it will actually record the source IP and the MAC address in a table form for use later. So for the ARP request, the node will actually do a layer 2 broadcast to all devices on the network. So all the actually devices that actually match the IP addresses in the broadcast will reply. However, if no devices respond to the ARP requests, the data packet is dropped because no frames can be created. So let's take a look at this diagram over here. So in this case, we have a host A trying to send the information to 10.10.0.3, and it has no ARP entry. So in the computer host A, the ARP table is empty. ARP table in this case is empty, so it is unable to send to the destination. So what computer A will do is it will broadcast a ARP requests to all the computers in the network. In this case, computer B, C, and D, and also for R1. So that it will try to obtain the destination MAC address and to reach the destination. So the broadcast ARP request is sent to all the devices, in this case to B, to C, to D, and those devices that contains the destination MAC address will actually reply. So the reply will come from this case host C, because host C is actually the destination that they want to send to. So host C will reply to host A with its own MAC address. And after it replies, host A will actually populate the or update the ARP table to ensure that it will know the destination of host C when it tries to send the next packet to host C again. So this is how it receives the update from host C upon receiving the updated information of the ARP. It will update the ARP cache in the host A with its IP address of 10.10.0.3 for host C, and also it will update the corresponding MAC address for host C in the ARP table. So in this case, when host A is trying to send another data packet to the destination, it does not need to do a ARP request broadcast anymore, because in host A, the ARP table, it already knows where to send the packet to using the IP address and the MAC address given in the ARP table, and it will send the data directly to the host under PCC. So the ARP is also used in the remote communication. So when the destination IPv4 host is on the local network, the frame will use the MAC address of this device as the destination MAC address. However, if the host is not on the local network, which is on another network, the source will use the ARP process to find out the MAC address for the router that is the gateway to reach the destination network. So in the event that the gateway entry is not in the table, an ARP request will be made to find out the MAC address of the gateway router. So in this case, let's see if we want to update the ARP table. So for example, host C has been removed from the network. It is no longer valid, and host A do not know. So host A may try to communicate to host C on this old setting on the ARP table, because it does not know that host C is already offline. So sometimes it is necessary to manually remove some of the entries in the ARP table to ensure that the ARP table is updated. So in this case, you can actually check out the ARP table on the Cisco router on this command over here, show IP ARP. And in this case, it will show the various MAC addresses and the lifetime of each MAC address for the corresponding IP address over here. Okay, the older the MAC address age, it will actually means that the MAC address will be less reliable compared to those addresses that are younger. So in this case, you have what we call the internet address and the physical address using this Windows command ARP-A, and you can also see the MAC addresses listed with the IPv4 addresses. How ARP can create a problem? In general, ARP can storm the network with the broadcasts, and if too many ARP broadcasts are sent in the network, it can actually create unnecessary overhead on the network media. It means that all the other computers will be busily trying to access the MAC information unnecessarily. On the other hand, the ARP can also be a security issue, because when the computer starts to request for ARP updates from the network, other hackers may try to intercept the information and will try to misrepresent the original sender as the fake receiver. So now let's take a look at the next portion on the LAN switches. So in general, a LAN switch is residing under the layer 2 of the OSI model. So it connects the end devices to a central intermediate devices for most Ethernet networks. And it performs what we call switching and filtering using the MAC addresses. Using the MAC address table, it is able to make what we call the packet forwarding decisions. And for IPv4 packets, they are actually handled under what we call the routers. So let's take a look at how the switch populates the MAC address table. So in the beginning, this is the MAC table under the switch. So notice that it only has the MAC addresses for the PC1. For PC2 and 3, it does not have the MAC addresses. So what it does is it will actually receive a broadcast frame from PC1 on port 1. So in this case, when PC1 actually sends a frame to the port 1 of the switch 1, it will actually enter the source MAC address and the switch port into the MAC address table of this switch. So because the destination address is a broadcast, the switch will flood the frames to all ports. So in this case, it will send the frames to PC2 and PC3 in this case. So upon the receiving the frame request from PC3, will actually respond with the corresponding frame to the switch 1. So in this case, switch 1 receives the updated frame from port 3 and it will update the MAC address table with the corresponding port 3 and PC3 MAC address. So in this case, the PC3 sends a frame to the port 3 of switch 1 and this is updated onto the MAC address table of the switch 1 and the source MAC address and the port number. This destination address and the port number will be associated with the PC3 in the MAC address table. And finally, the switch is now familiar with the location of PC3 and it is able to send information to the PC1 from PC3 because it now knows the source and destination addresses. So there are two kinds of transmission between the switch and the other end devices. So the first way is what we call a half duplex. So half duplex means at any one time only one direction is available. Only one direction data is available at any one time. Okay, so this means that the switch is sending information to hub and the hub should not send any information to the switch. However, this half duplex setting is a problem because it is higher potential for collision. And for the other hand, we have what we call a full duplex where information can flow continuously between both devices, and there is a dedicated switch port to support the transmission without any collision. In modern Cisco switches, we have what we call the auto MDIX setting, where it is able to detect the type of connection between the different devices, such as your switch to switch or switch to router or switch to PC and router to PC and so on, and you do not need to worry about the configuration of the different types of cables for the different interfaces. So in general, for Cisco switches, there are two ways of forwarding frames. The first way is what we call the store and forward. So in this case, the store and forward is to allow the switch to receive the entire frame, and after which it will compute the CRC, the cyclic redundancy check. If the cyclic redundancy check is passed, the switch will look up the destination address and send it to the destination port. For the second way is through the cut-through switching. So for cut-through switching is a faster way than the normal store and forward frame, because before the entire frame is received, it will actually start to transmit the frame to the destination address, okay, to the destination port. So in this case, it will have a lower level of latency, or what we call a lower level of less waiting time, okay, and it will immediately forward the packet to the destination. So in this case, the switch stores the first 64 bytes of the frame before forwarding, and this is most of the time where the collision will occur within the first 64 bytes. So if it's managed to store the first 64 bytes of the frame and forward, chances are it will not have most collision within the network. So in summary, we have covered in Chapter 5 the Ethernet LAN technology, and we also talk about the Ethernet being a Layer 2 protocol. It contains what we call the headers and trailers to encapsulate the information. It adheres to the IEEE 802.2 or 802.3 standards to provide what we call the MAC addressing and the error checking. It replaces hubs to ensure that there is a less possibility of frame collision in half duplex links. And layer 2 addressing supports the three different modes, the in-ear cast, multicast, and broadcast communications. And Ethernet uses what we call the address resolution protocol, ARP, to find the MAC addresses of the destination. Each node on the IP network has both a MAC address and the IP address, and you need to know both addresses in order to send the information to the destination. The ARP protocol resolves or finds the IPv4 addresses of the MAC addresses, and it will maintain these IPv4 addresses to MAC addresses in a table. So this table is known as the MAC address table, and it is used to make what we call the frame forwarding decision. Layer 3 switches, on the other hand, also be able to perform layer 3 routing using the IP packets, and they can also route data to the destination as quick as possible. Thank you.